and innocence, about cleanliness and filth, about ourselves and others. So they can be very othering and stigmatizing. So Priscilla Wald is really a touchstone. For those of you who might be interested in reading more about pandemic from a sociological or sociocultural perspective, I might recommend a best-selling book, Pandemic, by the award-winning science journalist Sonia Shaw. So she has written this book previous to the current COVID outbreak, but it's useful to put pandemic in historical perspective, and this book very much does that. All right, so I think if I had a show of hands, many of you have seen a number of the films that are shown on my next slide representing the outbreak narrative. And this is a standard cultural story that gets circulated and shared and told time and time again, and it does evolve over time. So if you look at a film like on the left, Contagion, which I bet many of the 47 participants in our webinar today have seen, you'll probably note that it has some differences from earlier representations of outbreak, like the 1990 film Outbreak, for example. And so, you know, I Am Legend is a Will Smith, starring Will Smith, is a remake of a Cold War film. And as you watch these different representations, you'll find that they do have a similar story, even as they take in current elements from the environment. And so, standard way of telling an outbreak story in our culture, according to Priscilla Wald, is that we have these formulaic plots, and you can see it in news stories, you can see it in films like the blockbusters I had on my last slide, and basically, these stories start with the emergence of a novel infection, and you can track it out in the newspaper stories. You know, it's a novel disease, it's a lethal disease, it's a new killer, to talk about headlines that actually occurred during COVID and during most other pandemics. It's pretty stock feature of the coverage. And then Wald and others say that the focus really turns to the global networks that facilitate viral spread. And so all the stories that we saw about the danger of airplanes, the danger of crossing borders, the way that spring break was serving as a means of spreading COVID because people were coming in from all over the world, hanging out on the beaches, going to parties, and then spreading. So that's kind of part of the phase of the standard COVID outbreak story that we're in right now. And then a lot of the work features the epidemiological business of containment. So what public health workers, what healthcare workers on the front lines and others are really doing, both front stage and backstage, in order to contain the spread of the virus. And then eventually, pandemics don't kill all of us. It concludes with containment and the story of how that was contained. And again, whether you're watching newspaper coverage of this or your latest viral blockbuster in the cinema, generally outbreak stories follow this very formulaic sort of plot. But the problem comes in when we associate particular groups or people as being responsible for viral spread. And so we can see that narratives become problems when they stigmatize people and groups, when they spread information, and when they blame the sick for being carriers of disease. And just to show you, I'm not saying it's right because it's not, but just to show you how deeply embedded culturally this sort of narrative arc is, we can think back during the bubonic plague, you know, when Yersinia pestis is sort of spreading through the medieval world. And there's an image here of the persecution of Jewish people in 1349. And this is an image that's in a manuscript that's in the Royal Library of Belgium, showing horrible mistreatment of the Jewish people that happened during that time. And so again, you know, just to counter this idea that sticks and stones don't break my bones, words are very powerful and are used for doing harm to other people. And that's obviously why we're here today. All right, so I happen to be working on a project right now that's tracking viral apocalyptic discourses. And these are the kinds of things that you see in 28 Days Later or The Walking Dead, which maybe some of you watch, one of the top grossing television shows of all time. And this is the vision of pandemic that we're most familiar with. And it happens to follow the standard outline of the outbreak narrative. And so it predicts the end of life as we know it from contagious disease, kind of like what we're all facing right now, where our work lives have been disrupted, school has changed in a way that's certainly unprecedented in my time. And so it brings together concerns about globalization and the spread of bodies across the globe, emerging infectious disease, economic, and in some cases, social collapse. And I would also add to that environmental disarray. And you are seeing storylines right now about how COVID was probably influenced by habitat loss and deforestation and so on and so forth. But again, with these kinds of stories that we tell culturally, we want to avoid at all costs stigmatizing and othering language. And so in practical terms, what are some problematic things that we want to be avoiding? One is anytime we equate a virus with a nationality or a group or a people. And most unfortunately, we see that happening right now. Faye's gonna give you in a few minutes some WHO reasons why we don't ever want to call a virus after a people. And it's really interesting from a racism perspective. You know, H1N1, which epidemiologists first thought broke out in 2009 in Mexico, it turns out was a USA, it wasn't our manufacturer, but it started in the United States. But interestingly enough, we didn't call it the USA virus, right? So I think that's a really good example to compare with here in terms of thinking of how harmful it is to equate a virus with a nationality or group. And then we did see and are seeing a lot of content, memes, cartoons, and so on that use racist tropes to depict people and the COVID virus itself, which is deeply problematic. Explicitly excluding and shunning particular groups of people, which is something that I imagine some of the student participants may have experienced around this particular outbreak. Rumor and misinformation sharing, which anytime we go on social media, I think there's a potential that we are encountering misinformation and rumor mongering. And then culturally biased, and I put this in air quotes, jokes, because of course these jokes do spread harmful views and make it seem as though it's legitimate to do so. And so, you know, anytime you're about to share content on social media, I'd say take a breath and think for a moment about what sorts of cultural stereotypes and assumptions are baked into this representation, and is that in fact something that I want to share. Now, we're here because the coronavirus is the latest in a long line of diseases that fuel mistrust, fear, and racism, as this headline on the top here suggests. And we will be talking in just a few minutes about some of the ways that the language and framing devices being used around COVID are fostering this climate. And then we're really going to get into some specific ways that we can show solidarity and allyship and reframe our communication patterns. So a lot of this will focus on our support for our Asian and Asian American students, staff, faculty, community members, and friends. But I did want to alert everybody to this really important and useful workbook from the NAACP. And it's called The Equity Implications of Coronavirus. And I study this stuff, but I found that it is just full of absolutely fantastic links and resources. And it kind of went through a lot of different populations and people who are affected by COVID. And so I also think we want to keep in our mind communities like frontline workers, immigrants, grandparents and caretakers, elder care workers, people without homes, those with disabilities, those who are incarcerated, our Native American communities, communities that experience health disparities, even our gig and low-income workers whose lives have been absolutely disrupted, as well as people who are suffering mental health distress and who are now isolated at home. So we're here today to talk about racism, specifically that's targeted against Asians and Asian Americans, but we also want to know that we're stronger together, and when we feel solidarity with these broader communities and the shared struggles we face, then we're all stronger together. So now what I'm going to do is give control of my screen over to Faye, and she's going to pick up with some of this theoretical and historical background on how Asians and Asian Americans have been framed in U.S. culture and cultural discourses. So Faye, go for it. My screen is your screen.
Thanks, Lisa. And thank you everyone for being here today. We obviously think that this is a very important topic. There's been a rise in hate incidences against Asian Americans, and we wanted to do our part to try to see how we could help to educate around this issue. So as Lisa said, I'm going to be offering the broader history behind the stereotypes of Asian Americans that we see circulating during the pandemic today. Though some people might say that these stereotypes seem to have come out of nowhere, these stereotypes have a very deeply embedded history within larger American history, and that's what I want to cover here. And I want to start by referencing the SARS outbreak in 2003. At the time, the SARS outbreak also led to hate incidences against Asians in the diaspora as a whole, since the SARS had come out of Hong Kong. And at the time, Asian American comedian Margaret Cho spoofed that what SARS stood for, to call it severe Asian racism syndrome, to capture what was what many Asians in the diaspora were experiencing at the time. And we once again see that here today with COVID-19. So these are the three topics I'm going to be talking about, how the, what was the origin of the uncivilized Asian other stereotype, and then I'll talk about how that stereotype then coincides during times of pandemic with that outbreak narrative that Lisa laid out for us, and how that then impacts those racialized bodies that are attached to certain stereotypes. And then I'll also be talking about, as Lisa had alluded to already, what is at stake in naming when diseases are named. All right, so let me start by giving that longer history of how the negative stereotypes of Asians in the U.S. has evolved. So I'm going to be start here by showing this image of San Francisco, and the reason I'm doing that is because the first time that white Americans in the U.S. came into contact with a large population of Asian Americans came during the gold rush. So you had a population of folks, usually working class people, who were trying to escape the highly industrialized East Coast, and they made their way to the West Coast where they believed that they'd be able to find their fortune, reestablish small businesses that had been wiped out in the industrialized East. And what they found instead was that they found a very diverse community, which at the time, just to give you an idea of how big of a shift this would be for folks who came out west, on the East Coast, about 1 in 10 people were people of color, as opposed to in San Francisco, half the population were people of color from all over, from all over the world. You had folks from Latin American countries who had come up to San Francisco to strike it rich. You had folks from Asian countries who had also come to San Francisco to strike it rich. And so what happens is that when folks from the East Coast come out to San Francisco and are unable to strike it rich, Chinese immigrants at the time became a scapegoat for the economic hardships that they faced. So in addition to Chinese immigrants being represented as an economic threat, Chinese immigrants at the time were seen as amoral. If you look at this political cartoon right there, it says Ah Sin was his name. And this is from a popular book at the time by Bret Hart called The Heathen Chinee. And so it was this immorality was associated with Chinese immigrants. This idea that they did not have the same kinds of Christian morals that Americans had, and that because of that, they brought in a whole host of other types of problems. And one of the problems that was attributed to Chinese immigrants at the time was that they did not eat the same kinds of foods as Americans, and that they were willing to eat just about anything. Here you can see in this political cartoon a Chinese person eating rats. And that becomes key later, because the idea was that because Chinese were willing to eat anything, because they were dirty, because they were immoral, that they become responsible for pandemics and for disease outbreaks later. And I wanted to bring this back to Denver, because I start by talking about San Francisco, but after 1869, when you have the last spike of the Transcontinental Railroad that is driven down, the Chinese railroad workers, many of them came to Denver. They established a Chinatown that was called Hop Alley, and the same kinds of economic scapegoating that we saw happening in San Francisco also occurred here in Denver. So in 1880, on Halloween actually, a fight broke out in a saloon, and that led to a full-blown race riot in Denver's Chinatown. And even though the population was pretty small, they experienced the losses during the riot were severe for the Chinese community. Chinatown's residents lost about $53,000 worth of property and goods. There was only one death, but like I said, Chinatown was basically destroyed because you had so much property loss. And the Chinese community in Denver reached out to local officials. They also reached out to their overseas representatives from China and to the national government, the federal government here in the US. But all of those different entities basically passed the buck to each other. Denver Chinatown residents were not given the aid that they needed to rebuild Chinatown to what it was. And so by the 1940s, that Chinatown basically disappeared. That Chinatown today would have been right in Lodo on 16th and I'm forgetting the street, but it was right off 16th Street. And I don't know, I want to say it was Arapahoe, but it was, oh no, and 16th and Larimer. So it was right there downtown. And there are no signs of that Chinatown today. And I want to say that the stereotype of Asian Americans as dirty and diseased did not just remain with Chinese immigrants, because at the time, Asian immigrants were seen kind of as a homogenous group. And so later on, what we see is that Chinese American fruit sellers in Los Angeles, for example, are given much higher scrutiny than other fruit peddlers, because rumors go around that their fruits are dirty and they are not sanitized as well as other fruit are. And this stereotype becomes overlaid to Japanese American family farmers as well, with rumors going around that the fruit that they've cultivated, the fruit that they sell, the produce that they sell are also dirty because Asian immigrants are uncleanly. And so after giving those historical examples, I want to show how these stereotypes are still with us. So the image of a website I'm showing here was this new New York City Chinese restaurant that has since closed. It was called Lucky Lee's, and the owner who opened the restaurant said that, you know, she wanted to create Chinese food that was healthy, basically. Chinese food that wouldn't leave customers feeling bloated and icky. That was her quote. And so this language, you know, follows those older stereotypes of the fact that, you know, Chinese food and Chinese people do not create food that are healthy for you. And that goes along with those ideas of, you know, uncleanliness, unhealthiness, and we still see that today in examples such as these. And finally, I want to give some specific examples of how the yellow peril stereotype is applied to public health. So the yellow peril stereotype is one, is this stereotype of a fear of Asians taking over, or Asians posing a threat to American civilization. And that really comes through in the examples that I'm going to give here. Now, in this political cartoon from 1882, you could see that there are these three ghosts that are emerging from Chinatown. And that's malaria on the left, smallpox in the middle, and leprosy. And again, since it was believed that Chinatowns were places of places where the population was dirty, where they didn't care about hygiene and cleanliness, places like Chinatown were shown and believed to be places where diseases were more likely to spread. And because Asian bodies were seen as being uncleanly, they then become subject to much more scrutiny. So this picture here is an immigration health checkpoint, and you see all of these Chinese immigrants who are being inspected by U.S. immigration health workers. And so the inspections that Chinese immigrants were subject to were much more invasive than screenings that were given to other immigrants. Often they were held at Angel Island for weeks on end while they were being inspected, whereas other immigrants were free to to disembark after a very cursory health screening. So we can see how those ideas of Chinese immigrants as being uncleanly then lead to then have this impact on, you know, the lives of Chinese immigrants who are trying to enter the United States. And beyond that, there was also the impact of the Chinese Immigration Exclusion Acts that really tried to halt Chinese immigration altogether. And those began as early as 1882, with the act being renewed in 1892, and then made permanent in 1902. And it's not until 1942 that the act is rescinded. And so the, I want to talk about how the these ideas come into play during plague outbreak responses, specifically the bubonic plague. The picture I'm showing here is in Honolulu, and you can see that a rope that is cordoning off Chinatown, and this was in response to a bubonic plague outbreak in Honolulu in 1899. So what happened was that after the bubonic plague came to Honolulu, and the bubonic plague had originated in China, after it came to Honolulu, the Chinatown was cordoned off. And while it was cordoned off, there was a fire that actually burned down most of Chinatown in Honolulu. And that wasn't intentional. It was just an accident that happened, that this fire burned out of control and happened to consume a fifth of Honolulu's buildings. But after the bubonic, after this plague outbreak in Honolulu, there were other instances of fires that were set on purpose in order to contain the plague and targeting a specific racial group. So for example, in 1924, when the bubonic plague appears in Los Angeles, Los Angeles authorities quarantined off Mexican-American neighborhoods because they, at that time, they believed that that was a source of where the bubonic plague was coming from. So I just wanted to give that example to show that it wasn't just Asian bodies or Asian neighborhoods that were targeted as a result of outbreaks, but other communities of color as well. The 1902 outbreak that I wanted to reference was actually in San Francisco, and there was a similar reaction as what you saw in Honolulu, where San Francisco's Chinatown was cordoned off at first, and they were quarantined, and no one was allowed to come and go. Because the San Francisco Chinese population had a little bit more clout there, they were able to get the quarantine opened after a few days. And so now I want, as Lisa had referenced earlier, I want to talk about the impact that naming can have, disease naming can have. So the World Health Organization actually has guidelines for disease, infectious disease naming best practices. And so they recommend that in naming a disease, you should avoid geographic locations, people's names, animal species or food, cultural, population, industry, and occupational references or terms that incite fear. So the reason why they say that geographic locations should be avoided is to basically minimize the impact that there might be to the people from those, that geographic location, or to tourism in that particular area. Of what we're referencing most in the talk today is the importance of not naming a disease after a culture or population, because that can lead to the blaming of that particular culture or population for the disease. Another recommendation they make is not to name a disease after an animal species or food, because there could be an impact on a particular industry as a result of that. So one example from the past was, you know, the swine flu, and there the worries about what naming a disease, a swine flu, could be have on a particular industry. And so in this next slide, I wanted to talk about and referencing that the earlier political cartoon about how Chinese immigrants were shown as eating rats. So this idea that this stereotype of Chinese people eating what is considered to be uncivilized food and then, you know, being blamed for disease outbreaks. So the rumor that was going around pretty early on with the when after the novel coronavirus was discovered was that it originated from humans, or, you know, humans in Wuhan, China, eating bat soup, and that, you know, there was no evidence of that. And actually the video that was circulating was not from someone in Wuhan and was not from, you know, even this during the time period of the outbreak, but that was being attributed as, you know, this is how it happened. So again, there is already this idea of, you know, blaming Chinese people and blaming their kind of uncivilized eating practices for the outbreak of the novel coronavirus. And, you know, the impact that we have been seeing is that, you know, Asian restaurants, especially Chinese restaurants, have been hard hit by attributing the novel coronavirus to Chinese people. So the image I have here is of a restaurant in New York City that is usually full, and here we see it completely empty. So there has been a large impact to Chinese restaurants across the U.S. And how they have been experiencing economic hardship as a result. And then another example is this one that came from London of a student from Taiwan who had not traveled in Wuhan, and yet when she arrived in the UK for a fellowship, she was denied her Airbnb reservation was denied simply because she was Chinese, even though she had not been to an area where there was an outbreak at that time. This is a headline from March 28th, and it talks about the rise in hate incidences against Asian Americans in the United States. And I want to give a reference for this number, 650. So this report came out approximately a week after the president called the coronavirus a Chinese flu. So that was about a week, and I want to compare that to how after the attacks on 9/11, and the week after that, the South Asian organization found that there had been 648 racist acts against people who were perceived to be Muslim. So I want to emphasize that these numbers are much, much, much higher than what is usually out there, and that it is comparable to other points in our history where a foreign group or where a group of Asian immigrants are blamed for something that occurs in the United States. And as Lisa said earlier, words matter. Official statements matter. And I'm reaching back here to a time in our in Colorado history, right after the attacks on Pearl Harbor in 1942. Whereas most of the country, the federal government chose to intern Japanese Americans, and many people in the country agreed with that decision. The then governor of Colorado, Ralph Carr, said that, you know, this is unconstitutional, and he publicly voiced his opposition to the detriment of his own political career, and he actually welcomed Japanese Americans who were displaced. He welcomed them into Colorado. The picture that I have here is of Japanese Americans at the dedication of a memorial for Ralph Governor Carr. And so I want to emphasize that it's very important for those in a leadership position to, say this isn't okay. And I was really happy to see that at the end of March, we saw official statements from here in CU Denver and from Denver's mayor coming out and saying, this is not okay. And, this is not who we are as a city. This is not who we are as a university, and that we need to stand up and say that we will not accept hate incidences against Asian Americans and Pacific Islanders because of stereotypes that they are responsible for the coronavirus. And now I think we're going to hand it over to Soyeon so that she can give us some tips on how we can respond to acts of hate, how to resist those acts of hate, and how to disrupt those.
And actually, I think this is Lisa again.
Oh, okay.
A couple of quick slides before Soyeon. So as we move into this third part of allyship and action, if we think about how we're here today because we don't want to spread hate and we don't want to spread racism, and we want to figure out what we can do to support others in our communities. So if we start to think about what values can underlie some of our stories, three come to mind. They're not the only three, but they're three values that can form the basis for a different kind of narrative. And the first is compassion. Susan Sontag once said in her book, Illness and Metaphor, that all of us hold dual citizenship in the kingdom of the well and the kingdom of the sick. And so one thing that we can do is try to have empathy with those who are sick instead of the fear, panic, and uncertainty that we so often and unfortunately see. Secondly, is to have our new stories be filled with a sense of unity and deep inclusion. So I wasn't able to find it, but I saw one editorial cartoon that had humanity united against virus. And if we bracket off for a minute whether we want to use the war metaphor in talking about COVID or not, and certainly we could have a very long discussion about the strengths and limits of that metaphor, what I liked about that was that it brought all human beings together in a quest against illness. And that's certainly a better image than infighting among countries and fighting of world leaders among scarce resources and so on. So to try to tell stories that promote unity. And then lastly, a sense of resilience. Even if we discover a vaccine for COVID and a cure for COVID, there will be other ways that Mother Nature evolves and other pandemics that will spread around the world. And so thinking about how to build resilient communities is really important, and that's a value to undergird our stories. This recent editorial cartoon makes the point that the virus doesn't care who you are or where you're from or what nationality you ascribe to. It's going to treat people ironically equally, right? Doesn't care in this image if you're Republican or Democrat. The virus is something that has evolved to attack human hosts. And in that sense, promoting unity, we are all human beings together. This was an early campaign in New York City to show some love to Chinatown by encouraging people to support businesses in Chinatown. Now, of course, some businesses have closed, and we can't necessarily support all businesses right now for that reason. But there are probably things that we can think about doing to support our populations who are from China and who are from Asia more broadly. Something else that some students in Europe were part of was a campaign to say, I am not a virus, to push back very explicitly against xenophobia. Some people have critiqued this campaign because it still does locate people as the spread of the virus and takes our attention away from, say, environmental conditions or healthcare structures that are problematic. So some things we can do to show solidarity is explicitly standing with our Asian and Asian American communities to again aim for compassion and unity. Soyeon in just a minute is going to talk about interrupting bias, ways to call it out or call in and engaging when you feel safe in doing so, refusing to share misinformation and rumors, and donating to a reputable aid organization. So those are a couple of ways of showing solidarity, but in just a moment, we're going to kind of get down into the nitty gritty. This slide is here of reputable and credible sources for health information, but I'm just gonna skip right over that to some of this other information from Soyeon because it's so rich and important. So I'm giving her control of the screen right now to take us through specific strategies we can employ. And Soyeon, your mute is still on.
Thank you, Faye and Lisa, for really providing the historical context and some overarching strategies that we as a community can do collectively together. When we sent out the survey, we received some questions about what do you do if you're the target? And I know personally, as an Asian American, I've experienced this personally. It could be the sly eye, it could be the dirty look. At times, it could be even the racial slur that I've heard. So we wanted to really give you some strategies. If you've experienced it, what are some possible ways to respond? And I want to really emphasize that when you are the target of such kind of bias and hate comments, remember it's not your fault. And because it's not your fault, it's also not your responsibility to have the perfect response. It really is a responsibility of our society and the perpetrator not to harass you. And so here are some things that I've learned from various trainings on how to respond if it happens to you. I think foremost, we should always keep in mind of our safety. Do you feel safe? And I usually listen to my gut. If I feel hot and my heart is racing, sometimes I know this isn't the place that I can speak up. Because I know when I have spoken up and it wasn't a situation, I've been hurt or I've been suspended or, you know, other adverse negative impact has made the situation worse. Are there people around you that you can solicit for help? Is the area where you're at well lit? Is there a close exit? If the situation gets worse, can you get out of there? However, if you do feel it's safe, I commend you, say something, because it can be empowering for you, but it could also be setting an example for others around you to speak up. And then certainly if it's out of your control or if you need assistance, ask for help, because some people may feel like you may not want the help. So just ask people who are around you, and certainly if there's a person of authority that can intervene. And what I've noticed lately is a lot of people are recording it with their phone. I think the public shaming through social media has had significant impact in drawing attention to what's happening, but also recording it for documentation. But certainly don't record it if you don't feel safe. It could actually aggravate the whole incident more. So what I wanted to really affirm is that if you don't feel safe, it's okay as a self-defense to ignore and walk away. I know at times when I've walked away, I felt like I was conceding to what they were saying, that I am saying that what they said is okay. But walking away is simply a way for us to choose not to engage at that time because we are scared of our safety. But we can definitely bring to light what's happening in other ways. As a bystander, I say you have a lot more power because the attention isn't drawn onto you by the perpetrator. So here are some really good bystander intervention training tips from Holler Back. They provide a number of different trainings for street harassment, sexual harassment, but I think a lot of these bystander intervention trainings can be applicable to anyone who's being targeted. They call it the 5 D's just as an easy way to remember it. And the first D is distract. Take an indirect approach to de-escalate the situation. So if you see an interaction maybe happening on a bus or the light rail, and someone is saying something racist to the target, what you may want to do is interject and just give your attention to the target and ask the target, how's it going? Can I ask for the time? Where are you headed to? Just by changing the conversation, changing that dynamic, you are showing support and you are disrupting it. Delegate. Certainly, if it's atrocious, ask for help. See if there is other people around you. And even in numbers can be very powerful. If there's one of your friends that's beside you, you can both intervene and interrupt what's happening. Delay. After the incident is over, check in with the person who's been harassed. I find it very affirming if you just ask the person who's been harassed, are you okay? For me, that acknowledges that what you saw was not right. What you saw was an injustice, and you're affirming the experience that I had by asking that question, are you okay? Other ways you can do it is just sit by the person who's being targeted. Just by sitting there so that they know that they're not alone and there's a body right next to them. And after the incident, it might help if you ask them if you can accompany them to their next destination, or just say, let's get out of there, just to pull them away from the scene. And definitely direct, speak up. That's what we all aspire to do. But I recognize when we are immobilized by fear, we don't have it in us. So speak up when you can, speak up when you feel safe, but definitely I think the more we do it, the more empowered we feel. And just calling it out by saying stop it, that's offensive, could really call someone out on what they're doing is not right and it is being noticed. As again, document. And I think what's bringing to light about the treatment and the racism against Asian Americans is that it's being recorded. Thank goodness for our phones with video, because we are capturing what is happening. Oftentimes when we share our stories of injustice, of a sly eye or bullying, some people may not take it for truth. But if you have an actual video documentation, there is no denying it. So I say document it if you can, but please be mindful to keep a safe distance, because if you record it and the perpetrator sees you, it might just agitate the situation and make it worse. And certainly if you record it, ask the person who's being targeted for their permission to post it, to share it, or give it to them. Never post something online without their permission. And I think the best way that everyone could be an ally is when you see it happen, keep your attention to the person who's being harassed so that they know that you see them, that you see what's happening, and make sure that you can show some kind of support. Just if it's just sitting by them, if it's interrupting, and engaging in conversation so that they can get their mind off of what's happening. But those are multiple kind ways that we can be an ally. Oops. I'm sorry, can we go back, Lisa?
Yes, we can. Let's see.
There I go. I think another powerful tool for us to be allies, all of us, is to report it. As Lisa said, it's important to share the stories that are happening. And like we are becoming more aware of these anti-Asian assaults because of the documentation through social media, as well as people are reporting it. So depending on where you are, there are various organizations that you can report it. We have the Equity Office. If you're a student, faculty, or staff, report it to the Equity Office that serves CU Denver and Anschutz. The Campus Police Department, we have a Auraria campus in CU Anschutz. And now that we're at the shelter in place mandate, obviously we're not at the campuses, but if you see it happening in your community, report it to the police department. And certainly if you see physical assault, there is no question, dial 911. That is an emergency. But after the incident, you know, definitely report it to the police department. And also the a number of Asian American associations and civil rights organizations have created a centralized Asian hate crime reporting site, a website. There's three, but the one I wanted to share with you is established by the Asian Americans Advancing Justice, called standagainsthatred.org, where you could read the narratives and stories of people sharing their story. And I think as a person who's been harassed, it can be affirming, like, oh my gosh, it's not just happening to me. Sometimes as a person, a victim of being a target of racism, sometimes we internalize it and think it's all about something that we did when it really is the perpetrator's fault. And so we need to report it. But standagainsthatred.org is an excellent site because they provide the reporting site in multiple Asian languages. And they are collecting this national data so that they can actually get a better sense of where it's happening, who are the targets, and maybe create some congressional policy or advocate at a national level in with legal and legal policies. So we've only hit the surface on, Lisa, could you, thank you. We've only hit the surface in terms of what are some strategies of how to intervene and how to stand up. I wanna share with you some excellent resources that I've used in terms of providing training or even talking about it with students. But the Anti-Defamation League, we have a branch here in Colorado, but they've been around for over 115 years, where their work is really to try to eliminate bias. And they provide in-person trainings as well as a number of different lesson plans for teachers, as well as articles, strategies that parents can have with their kids. So during this time of stay-at-home mandate, if you are wanting to know what can you all do, these are some of the excellent sites on where you can get some additional strategies on how to address it. The Asian American Advancing Justice and Holler Back are actually going to be collaborating together to provide a training specifically to support our Asian American community. So I've shared with you some of the strategies that Holler Back uses, the 5 D's, but they are really tailoring it. What do we do now for our Asian American community when we see this happen? Southern Poverty Law Center, again, another very established organization that provides allyship training. They have a branch called Teaching Tolerance. There's a really good video of high school students, Asian American high school students, sharing their experiences, the things, the racial epitaphs that they've heard in the classroom, and just some of the microaggressions, such as students avoiding them in the classroom, or students even saying, asking, do they have the coronavirus? I think this teaching tolerance is really geared for high school students and could be a really good platform to have conversations with your children and with youth. We want to give some time to Dr. Frank Kim. He is the director of our CU Denver Counseling Center. For many of us who've been targeted, are fearful of being targeted, and for all of us who are dealing with the anxiety and stress of what's going on and uncertainty what's going to happen to us personally, financially, mentally, Dr. Kim is going to share some insights on what you can do for self-care, especially if you've been targeted, but as well as general self-care tips. So Frank, if you can share some of your expertise. Thank you.
Okay. Thanks, Soyan. Really appreciate taking some of this precious minutes here for this very important topic. Just a few words as background. You know, racism by definition is a dehumanizing action. You know, it strives to make race the essential explanation for the difficulties experienced by the person who's expressing racist views and behavior. It's almost like they are injustice collecting, if you will. And in that sense, it doesn't really matter, obviously, you know, if you've been victimized. It has nothing to do with you as an individual. That being said, reactions will reactions to racist incidents and experiences will vary by the individual. And I would say rarely is an individual not impacted. It's really a collective experience, but it's one that's felt very personal. So I think it does have an impact in terms of you know, how we function as individuals. excuse me. So just maybe some of these are obvious, but people get impacted by their experience, and this is true with negative experiences. It's almost like it encodes in us, and I'll talk about that in just a second. An individual will interpret their world through the assumptions or templates or beliefs, if you will, that are formed by these experiences. So if you have a negative experience and it's been repeated over time, as many times racism has been experienced by most of us, or other isms, what happens is that it starts to sort of change and modify our worldview. And we'll be talking about that in just a second as well. These templates, these assumptions, reside in our less conscious self. So, you know, bear with me here. I'm a psychologist, so, you know, talk about unconscious and consciousness. But it tends to reside in, out of awareness. And because of that, it can exert really a disproportionate influence on how we think, feel, and behave. So if you can sort of picture this, five layers, this is from a cognitive behavioral theory, behaviors on top, then underneath behavior you have affect or your feelings, then you have cognitions under that, so how what we're thinking. The cognitions can be conscious or unconscious or subconscious. And then below the cognition, you're going to have assumptions or those templates that I was referencing, or mini beliefs, if you want to think of it that way. And then at the very bottom are core beliefs. And if you draw an arrow from core beliefs all the way up to behavior, that's how behavior gets created. So that's a Cliff Notes version, but that's kind of the model that you want to keep in mind. So at the very bottom, you have core beliefs that leads to assumptions. Are templates. These assumptions all have produced cognitions or thoughts, and then the thoughts lead to affect, and affect and how you think will determine your behavior. So if you think about that model for a second, then the insidiousness of experiencing a racist experience incident is that you know, it's upsetting, and you know, we get worked up and all that kind of thing, but it's what you do with that afterwards, that experience, and the danger, at least from a psychological perspective, would be that below the consciousness, if you will, in where the assumptions reside, these templates, you can start to form an idea or a belief, an erroneous belief, but a belief that you are not as good as other people. So that's the racism. That's the racist philosophy, right? That's what they're trying to achieve. They're going to dehumanize you. They're going to say that you're not as good as. But the thing is that if it forms in your less conscious self, then you're not going to be aware of it, and therefore you're going to start to act in accordance. There's another real key principle here, and it's how we're sort of built. And that is that if you have a belief, you're going to find evidence that it's true. And if that's the case, think about that. Erroneous belief, you're not as good as, will be reinforced because you're going to be, in essence, finding evidence in through your experience that it's true. Of course, that's doesn't make an objective or correct. It just means that you're looking through a certain lens, if you will. So the danger of these racism or other isms is that it actually can impact an individual's sense of self, and it uses this mechanism, if you will. So what you can do about it is, and you've heard this before, is that self-awareness from a personal standpoint is incredibly important. So if you start noticing that there are things that you're not doing as well, or maybe your performance is falling off, or you're getting caught up in your head, that kind of thing, you might want to sort of dial it back a little bit and pay some attention to the internal dialogue that you're having. What are you saying to yourself? That kind of thing. You know, when a person is makes a racist comment to me, of course I'm going to be upset. And then the danger would be that I sort of own that somehow there's some legitimacy to it. The easiest thing to do is to say, wait a minute, that's that person's problem, which it is, of course. You don't own those kinds of statements, but to do that, you have to be really careful and you have to pay some attention. So self-awareness is really the big one. We call them cognitive challenges. And those are things that you can do to sort of depower, if you will, those statements. Another thing you can do is something we call behavioral activation, and that is basically do something. You'll see this a lot in responses to community events where there's been like racism or violence and whatnot. If you seek out your friends or your family, seek out people that are allies, gather support, participate in activism, if you will. All of these things are really important in terms of pulling oneself out and allowing one from a psychological standpoint to really start to feel better, engage others, that kind of thing. Definitely pay attention to your values. Pay attention to the values of your allies. When we are experiencing something like this, it's really easy to over-focus on the in this case, racism. So what you want to do is you need to be aware, but you also need to make sure that you balance it out a little bit. So remind yourself of your values, your core values, if you will. And then, of course, the last thing, and I'll stop on this, is self-care is really, really important. And self-care are all those things that people are doing, and I'm sure you've heard about. But self-care would include making sure that you get enough rest, that you eat good food, that kind of thing, that you work in, things like exercise and whatnot. Pay attention to all those things. Do things that allow you to take a break from some of this stuff. Otherwise your natural chemistry is going to be go a little out of whack. So I'll stop there and pass it back to Soyan.
Thank you, Dr. Kim, and thank you for all those rich suggestions. I did get a question if we can maybe have some slides with those specific strategies. We'll try to include it in this presentation for future. And again, we have a great resource of counseling centers, so please feel free to reach out to the various counseling centers, the ones in the community. I do want to put in a plug for the Asian Pacific Development Center, because they are really doing outreach to our Asian American Pacific Islander community specifically for victim assistance right now. If you've been feeling like you've been targeted and don't have health insurance, they could provide telehealth for you. So thank you very much, Dr. Kim, for sharing. And I'd like to go ahead and hand it over to Lisa to sort of round out the rest of our presentation.
All right, great. So just to review, we wanted to offer the broader communicative and historical context and offer some tools for support, whether it was the 5 Ds that Soyeon gave us, or some of the pictures of self-care that Frank gave us. So we ended with allyship and action. What we would like to do next is have a few minutes of questions. And so we're asking if people, I think James will change the permissions on the chat settings so that people can type in some questions and we can have some responses from the panelists. So go ahead, everybody, and take a moment to submit a question if you have one. We did, when we were working on this, try to work in some answers to some of the questions that we got. So we had one from someone asking about them being kind of tired of not responding, but not being quite sure of when to respond. And so Soyeon made sure, for example, that she had some information about the delayed response or the documentation and so on. So please go ahead and type in any questions.
I did see one question that was sent to us about addressing racism on social media. And obviously this is on the rise as we are all at the, you know, shelter in place. We're on our computers quite a bit. And so I wanted to answer some of those questions, but also, you know, ask our panelists for additional ideas too. For me personally, I find that it's been affirming to find groups where my stories are validated. And so a lot of the people that I know who've been targeted, they've been sharing it on social media so that they are affirmed of their experience and people know about it. But when you see obviously attacks on Asian Americans, I would say you can maybe provide a link for a counter argument. You engaging in a discourse with your opinion may not necessarily change their mind, but if you can provide a credible source that discounts what they're saying, and maybe with a sentence or, you know, what you said is not true, WHO says such and such, is a way to educate for everyone else who's reading that post and give them a link to a reliable source that could do the counter argument for you. I find sometimes when you just get engaged in back and forth with the social media, on social media, just with your opinions, that's not going to resolve it because they are all entrenched in their own beliefs. But if you have facts, that's a good way to combat it. And sometimes for my own self-care, I have to just block them. It is not healthy for me to see some of the atrocious things that are going on. The blaming that it's the Chinese virus, or blaming it's because of what we eat. And I do not need to be subjected to that. And so I just block them because I can't handle it. So that's me personally, but I think using facts is the best way to combat it. Other questions? I think some of the other questions that we had earlier is how is this pandemic and scapegoat for politicians and lawmakers who are trying to benefit from this crisis? I do feel, and maybe Lisa and Faye, you can intervene. I think calling it the Chinese virus is definitely scapegoating China. And I do fear what the narrative may be in the future when this pandemic crisis passes and more countries are wanting to point their finger at China. And there might be some culpability, but I think labeling it as a Chinese virus or even using that rhetoric in conversation is really going to be labeling anyone who may be perceived to be Chinese for being responsible.
Yes, I agree with that, Soyeon. And I also think that the labeling of us as at war in terms of our COVID response also sort of allows actions that wouldn't be permissible during some other time. And so then you start to see people defending actions that maybe put your nation ahead of other nations in terms of, well, we deserve all the supplies and we're not going to share with others, or suspending human subjects protections for research because, well, we're at war against COVID, so we don't need to do all of the protocols beforehand. You know, it's an emergency situation, and sure, we have emergency medicine and we have ethical protocols for that. But I think, you know, there's the use of this by both members of governments from the US, China, and other nations. And then there's also the way that this gets used kind of domestically in terms of it being a war and scapegoating and so on and so forth. So there's a couple layers at which I think this is working. And I think as citizens, it's really our job not to accept any of these framing devices and to say, wait a minute, what is the implication of calling it this instead of that, or labeling it a war, or labeling it a national disaster, or, you know, what if we think about this as a sort of global thing that we're all going through together? And so, you know, one of the pleas here from this is just to really ask questions about all the language and framing devices that we're seeing, and then to be able to share using social media the more positive stories and the stories of unity, allyship, standing together, and resilience.
There was another question posed on what additional strategies could you all share that people have personally used if they've been a target, or how to be an ally?
So I'll share for me, as an ally, one of the things that I do is privately call people out. So, you know, sometimes on social media, I might call people out, or like Soyeon said, might post a counter link, or even make a new post that just, you know, celebrates some positive aspect. So I was thinking of some of the organizations that Soyeon was sharing earlier and thinking, oh, I'm gonna call attention to the good work that they're doing in future social media posts. But then sometimes I just have to write somebody and say, hey, you know what? I really respect you, but I've gotta say, I noticed you used this language today. And I might use a question to say, you know, there's this larger history here. And when we use language like that, it stigmatizes others. It kind of depends on the individual relationship, but sometimes just privately letting someone know that the language that they have used is problematic can be a useful first step. I don't know, you know, Faye and others probably have great strategies to share too.
I just want to say that I actually use the same kind of strategies as you, Lisa, because I often, depending on the person, I don't know what their intentions might have been. So talking to them personally, or, you know, putting a post up that counters those arguments, I find is doesn't necessarily put that person on the spot in the same way as if I just try to respond to that person's post and put a counter argument. So I think that those are, that I use those same types of responses.
I've seen Brenda Allen use humor a lot, and I just happen to not be that funny. So I'm the person who's always thinking of the funny quip, you know, 5 minutes later when I'm walking out the door. But I've really admired that Brenda is sometimes able to use humor on the spot to defuse a situation and kind of ask an invitational question that really makes the person who used the offensive language think. But she's able to do it in this really gifted way so that it's not face-threatening to the original speaker, right? So she kind of uses humor and diffuses it, but then says, hey, wait a minute, in the question. And I'm not even funny enough to do that as an example now, but I imagine that some of our participants do have the humor skills that they can kind of carry that off and ask a question in a way that is very revealing.
Thank you all for sharing. I really appreciate you all joining us today, and I'm sure we can have this conversation for a lot longer, but I want to be mindful of everyone's time. But we do have a couple of other video teleconference sessions happening. We have one this coming Thursday, facilitated by two alumni from CU Denver, and they will be doing one on being Asian during the time of COVID-19. To really decompress and have a forum for stories that students can share. We're also planning to do one next week on April 14th, and I'll be sending you more information, more again about the racialization of this disease and how damaging it can be, but also what could we do at a at a legal and policy level to address it, and then also on ways that we can treat the trauma resulting from this COVID-19. So thank you all for joining us. We will be sending out a survey to you all. If you could please give us some feedback, we'll send out the slideshow as well for your record. But thank you very much, and we hope to see you at our next session on April 9th, 5 to 7 p.m. Thank you. Thank you again to all our panelists, and I want to also do a shout out to James Speed, who's been managing our chat. But thank you, Lisa and Faye, for taking the time to present this valuable information and context. And thank you, Frank Kim, for joining us with your insights on how to exercise self-care. It's all valuable information. Enjoy the rest of your day.
Hi, everybody.
How do you all feel?
Good, yeah. Can we stop the recording?
Yes.